Most of human history, people used fire as a tool. They accepted that it was part of the environment, and they were very well aware of how it affects all the ecosystem processes. It's only in the last century that we thought it was important to control it and to stop it. And that hasn't worked out so well. Most years, one state or another in the Western United States is setting records for the largest fires ever seen. So when you couple climate changes and associated weather changes with human population changes and with a legacy of land management activities, you end up explaining most of what we're seeing in terms of more extreme fires. We're not going to succeed by doing more of the same and doing it more efficiently. We have to do things different. I'm Mark Finney. I'm a research forester. I work for the U.S. Forest Service at the Missoula Fire Sciences Laboratory. I grew up in Golden, Colorado. I spent my time playing in the woods, hiking, fishing, just doing a lot of outdoor activities. After high school, I took a summer job as a firefighter working for the Bureau of Land Management and got my first experience with wildfire operations and management. I enrolled at Colorado State University in forestry and was introduced to how plants and animals were adapted to fire effects. Native Americans used to burn these areas very frequently. By doing that, what's accomplished is the fuels remain in a very low condition. There's hardly any needle litter. We don't have the fuel conditions that would support a high-intensity fire. Fire would still spread. That's not really the point of stopping fires. It's to make sure that when they do come through, that you have very moderate fire effects that sustain these ecosystems rather than destroy them. I've been working at the Missoula Fire Sciences Laboratory since 1993. The Fire Sciences Lab has three primary areas of interest: fire behavior, fire effects, and fire ecology, and the third is smoke production. Fire behavior prediction wasn't a thing until about 1972. A new fire behavior model was produced, and this, for the first time, gave people the ability to put in fuels, topography, weather information, and make a mathematical calculation for how fast fires would spread and what their intensity would be. But it has a lot of limitations and doesn't tell you how fire spread happens, just that it does. And so that's our goal, is to replace that with a physically based model that helps us explain, not just predict. So we are standing in the burn chamber where we do a lot of different experiments and generate a lot of data off of these exact kinds of burns. The way we have to do our research is by dividing the fire spread process into little pieces, studying them separately, and then bringing them back together again in a model. We're going to ignite this and we will have a very nice stationary flame zone, and then we will start changing a few variables and see how that affects the fire behavior. We can put the measurements and the equations that we get directly into fire behavior models, and we use those models then to have a physical description for how fires behave. The main questions that we're still trying to understand is, how does fuel burn? How is the heat being transferred from what's burning to the adjacent fuel materials? If we're going to have hope of developing predictive tools for land management, these have to be fairly simple. The challenge of replacing our current modeling with new physical models is that physical models are far more complex. They require more data to run, but they also require more processing. This is where our partnership with Google Research comes in. What we're doing is using Google's massive compute infrastructure and exercising that model hundreds of billions of times in order to generate probability surfaces, to train the machine learning surrogate model on that. The Forest Service does not have the kind of computing power, the data storage, or the expertise to produce those machine learning models. So our partnership with Google Research really is vital to moving our fire modeling forward. So here's our wind speed here, 0 to 10 meters per second across a range of fuel moistures. Let me just show here, I'll just change one characteristic and I generate the prediction. There, boom. Just like that, it does thousands of calculations. This is a major advancement in processing. This is the only model of its kind that's capable of doing these calculations and being a general purpose fire behavior model that can be embedded in lots and lots of different systems. Machine learning and AI can play an important role in solving a number of problems that we have if we apply them to the right problems. And then I think they can be of great value. When I see losses to our wildlands or to our communities, I think that, well, this is a tragedy because these are avoidable. Wildland fires are a necessity, but wildland fire disasters are not. It is my hope that in the near future, the work we're doing right now will lead to dramatic improvements in our confidence to manage fires, to predict them, and to manage our wildlands and nearby communities in ways that they're sustained by fire rather than being destroyed. The better we are at planning for wildfires and avoiding them and mitigating, the more resilient we are. The less severe fires will be and the more ready we are to recover from them.